Well, thank you for coming today. I want to give you an update on what has occurred since I vetoed the budget that was passed last week by our legislature during our special session. As we have discussed several times, we did protect temporarily our core human services and health services of the state of Oklahoma, which was a big priority for myself. I want you to know that my office, and me in particular, have been overwhelmed by the amount of comment, public support, and frankly, just thank you from many Oklahomans who have reached out to me and to people around me to say, thank goodness, let's fix the problems that we have at the Capitol. Let's quit kicking the can down the road. Let's deal with the issues that are in front of us. And thank you for not giving up and frankly, just for not thinking this is the best we can do, because I think we can do better as Oklahomans. So I've heard from people from all across the state, all kinds of different professions and industries, all walks of life, men and women, basically. And they all agree that it is time that we put our state on a predictable, sustainable path forward with our budget and our budget structure. They certainly don't want to go through another year like we've been through this year with a budget shortfall, in which we will be coming back in February, which is just 2.5 months from now, in another legislative session with another large shortfall of somewhere close to over $600 million because of the one-time monies we used this year and because of the one-time monies and revolving funds that were being used in the bill that I line item vetoed. Many are saying that they are working outside of this building, outside of even our elected officials, to talk to the business community, talk to civic leaders from, like I said, all walks of life to find different ideas, different ways to give some options to not only myself, but certainly to our legislators, and to be able to solve our long-term budget problems. Most have expressed support for the plan that received, frankly, 74% of the House and Senate support on Plan A Plus that failed by 5 votes recently, and suggested that they were disappointed that we came so very close and then we gave up. And then we went ahead and cut and went home. There are a lot of people suggesting lots of different ideas. I have visited with every living governor that there is, Republican and Democrat, along with many other past and former candidates for all kinds of office, even people who ran against me for other different positions. And I appreciate their advice. I appreciate their support on different things that we have talked to. But I have to tell you that after the response I've received since Friday night when I line item vetoed portions of the budget, that the response I have received has been overwhelming and frankly very inspiring, very encouraging, that people know and understand that it's important that we fix our state's problems and that we not continue to kick the can down the road, and that we must put our state on a path towards success. And so as a result of that, result of listening to them and giving them frankly some time to continue these discussions and to give us a little bit of a cooling off period from a very stressful 8-week special session, long special session, and to give legislators and myself and many in the business community time to talk and to listen about various ideas of how to put our state on a predictable, stable path, I will give you a date next week in which we will begin our special session. Try and allow some time for people to think, to consider about what's really important to our state and how we're going to reach success in getting there. So, but I do want to talk to you about a couple of actions I am taking today and have already actually taken to bring additional focus to things that many people have talked about, not only the past 8 weeks, but for many, many years in our state. And that is, how can we focus on bringing more efficiencies and bringing more consolidation of services, especially administrative costs of services for our state government? How can we do that? And that's certainly been a big debate during this special session. So I have signed several executive orders today. Two executive orders that are separate deal with administrative consolidation of higher education with our colleges and universities. And let me repeat that, administrative cost consolidation of our colleges and universities. And the second executive order deals with administrative costs, shared services consolidation of our K through 12 education schools. We know that we have well over 500 school districts across the state of Oklahoma. And so those are two issues that for a long period of time we've discussed as a need that we need to address. There are ways that we can find more efficiency. We can get more money into the classroom, to teachers, and to pay, and hopefully be able to lower our college students' debt and time that they spend going to colleges and make things more efficient for them too. The third executive order that I have signed deals with our state agencies and state money, and specifically for what many of us believe is unnecessary items, such as swag items, whether it is your coffee cups, your pens, your promotional items that are not necessary to the core mission of an agency. And so I have also signed that during the special session. And I also want to remind you that during my last special session call, I talked a lot about how we have to have more consolidation of entities to save money and more efficiencies in all areas of government, and certainly we had that discussion. But during special session, as we saw, many of the legislators said, I'm voting no on this budget, whichever budget might have been, whichever revenue proposal it might have been, because we had several, because we want to be able to find a way to eliminate waste and inefficiencies in government. And that was a call and a comment that I heard many, many times. But by the way, they also said they wanted to audit our state agencies, which does take time. So I wanted to give you a little bit of an update on auditing of state agencies. So since I've been governor, I have issued 22 requests to the state auditor to audit various agencies. And we have an agency head, or maybe some other cabinet secretary official that has been replaced or maybe is leaving some entity, I always ask for an agency audit, just because I think it's the right thing to do. When someone leaves and the new person comes in, they need to know where that agency stands and what has gone on within that agency. So I have always been and always will support looking for ways to eliminate waste, to find ways to create more efficiency in government. That's why I've signed these two executive orders that deal with two of our costly entities, which are very important to our state and education, but also to address any type of excessive spending that we might have with swag items that I mentioned, and also to continue to support the auditing of agencies, which I always have. And by the way, legislators have the ability, and they should use it, have the ability by law, both the House and Senate, to ask for audits too. In fact, I think there was a committee assigned to look into one of our agencies just this week. But they have the ability also, besides myself and besides the Attorney General and the auditor, to also deal with the audits itself. I still think that while we're looking at efficiencies, we're looking at ways to find areas to consolidate for administrative costs, we're looking at swag items, that we still must find ways to deal with our $215 million budget shortfall that we had this year and our looming shortfall we will have next year, which will be close to $600 million because we have been using non-recurring revenue to balance our budget for many, many years, which I've been cautioning people for a long period of time. And when we come back in 2.5 months, we're going to have close to a $600 million shortfall in election year, which is a great concern to me. I do think that we can find ways to be efficient, We can do the audits, we can work on eliminating waste, we can find ways to consolidate administrative costs of various entities, while also solving Oklahoma's structural imbalance of our state budget and finding teachers a pay raise, and state employees certainly. I think all those goals are compatible if we're willing to work hard, do the hard work, spend the time, which we have been spending a lot of time, but we didn't finish our job. We just didn't finish last Friday when people left. Now I want to share a little bit more detail about the executive order about the State Board of Education. We have talked with the Superintendent of Public Education and given her a notice of this. The order directs the State Board of Education, with the assistance of the State Superintendent of Public Instruction, to compile a list by September 1st of 2018, plenty of time, of every public school district that spends less than 60% of its budget on instructional expenditures. Of every school, public school district that spends less than 60% of its budget on instructional expenditures. In other words, we're trying to lower the administrative costs, whether it is maintenance of buses, whether it is efficiencies with energy, whether it is personnel, payroll, curriculum, school books, it could be whatever. They might find ways to help save money so we can get more of that money back to the teachers in the classrooms. School districts are designated for administrative costs, consolidation, or annexation are to be notified by July of 2019, so we give them plenty of time, with the districts required to submit a plan for administrative cost consolidation, and as I mentioned, such as human resources, purchasing, accounting, technology, maintenance, or certainly to develop a plan for that annexation if they choose to do that by the year January 1st of 2020. And then we give them plenty of time to implement that by the 2021 school year. And so we try to be reasonable in giving both the state board, the schools themselves, and certainly the superintendent of public instruction to develop a plan of ways to save on administrative shared services within our school districts that are spending less than 60% of their money going to instruction, public instruction in the classroom. The most important component of successful educational outcomes, of course, is with quality teachers. And that is why in my call, I asked the legislature to help me find a way to find a pay raise for our teachers and to make sure that our teachers have good instructional material in their classrooms, have the technology that they need to be able to offer our students the best education possible. And it's important that we send a greater percentage of our taxpayer dollars directly to support the classroom and to support the teachers rather than non-instructive costs. And that's why I've issued this order. So we got to get serious about it. As I mentioned, we got over 500 school districts in our state. In cooperation with the regents and the chancellor, who has had an ongoing task force talking about our higher education system and our colleges and universities and our curriculum and our courses and our degrees and STEM education and all the great things they've been working on, and I commend them and thank them for their work. But in order to back them up more, I've issued an executive order that directs Oklahoma's higher education chancellor and the state Regents for Higher Education to develop a plan for administrative cost consolidation of universities, colleges, centers, branch campuses by December of 2018, and that plan should be executed by December of 2019, so they have time to work on that. Administrative cost consolidation will allow for more effective distribution of resources, certainly for educational programs throughout our state to better serve our students. It will also allow higher education to be able to focus on areas that will strengthen our career pathways, basically to help us determine what is the most needed degrees and certificates, what's the pathway to get those degrees and certificates and get them into the workforce and to help our employers find the workforce that they need. Also, it'll help us with certainly providing fewer dropouts. Many times if it takes a student 5 or 6 years and racking up college debt and it's taking a long period of time. They drop out of college, thus they're not in the workforce as a degreed person. So that'll help them graduate on time, hopefully more efficiently. Administrative costs consolidation will also lead to significant administrative savings. If you look at just the costs we have with all of our centers across the state with personnel, purchasing, once again, maintenance, IT, energy savings, and there's some great examples of energy savings that have been done at some of our major colleges and campuses across the state. OSU has done a tremendous job in reducing their energy costs, but looking for those efficiencies will go a long ways. So I think these two major reform executive orders for education will go a long way to improving our education outcomes. We'll certainly be wiser, help us be wiser with our resources. And I think we owe that to our taxpayers, and we owe it to our students that are, and our parents that are spending hard-earned money to get a good education. The third executive order that I mentioned deals with reinforcing what I've asked our cabinet secretaries to do over the last couple of years, and that is to really monitor the state agencies when it comes to how they spend their money on things that's not their core mission, especially as it relates to non-essential items such as the swag items that I mentioned a few moments ago. And by the way, we had a bill that went through session that dealt with swag items, the cups, the pens, the trophies, bumper stickers, whatever it might be, and it failed in the legislative session. So that's why I'm issuing this executive order. I understand and know that a lot of our Oklahomans have felt frustrated this whole year. I know our legislators have been frustrated, and I know I've been frustrated. But we have to continue to make progress for our state. We have to solve the big problems, bring big ideas to the table, bring big action, and not just settle, because as I heard during debate last week, which really riled me up, this is just the best we can do. It's not the best we can do. We are better than that as a state, and we owe it to our people not to give up the fight, to fight for being excellent in everything. We certainly expect that with our football teams, with the Thunder, or whoever it might be. We expect that excellence. And so one of the other things I think that's important for our state is to help our governor. And my term ends in 13 months. But I would ask the legislature, and they've already considered this many times, they just haven't passed it yet, but for future governors, it would be wise if they would consider giving governors more power and authority over boards and commissions. Governors appoint people to boards and commissions, so do the House members and the Senate members appoint people. But I think people don't always understand that the governor doesn't have the absolute authority to remove a person or hire a person over a certain agency. The boards and commissions, for the most part, make those decisions. In certain cases, I can, but majority of the state, there are boards and commissions appointed by a governor or by House of Representative members or by senators. So it's hard for a governor. We certainly get all the blame if there is something that goes wrong, but it's hard for us to be able to correct some things. So I think it would be wise in the future. Many people have talked about this for decades, that we have a weak power structure within the governor itself because of all the boards and commissions, but that is something that we might want to consider in looking at our future governors and putting them more in charge of the boards and commissions. There are times that in governor's appointments, there are some boards that may have 6-year appointments, 4-year appointments, 9-year appointments. There are times when you're almost through with your whole term before you get the majority of your members on a board to make the kinds of changes policy-wise that you may be interested in. So that's a summary of some of the things that are going on. Like I said, I will give you a date next week. We have had so many conversations. Most of my nights are up well past midnight, starting early in the morning. My staff, too, has been working overtime, talking to our legislators, talking to our business community, certainly our policy majors, talking to our agencies in detail about things that they need, certainly about budget figures. And it's important that we put Oklahoma in a better place. I think we haven't done our best yet. We need to seize the moment. We need to address the big issues, fix the problems, put Oklahoma on a path that we can all be proud of to make us a great place to live, work, and invest, and raise a family. And that's been solely my goal, and it's one that I think we're all up to as fellow Oklahomans. So I'll be happy to take some questions now.
Are there any school districts that spend less than 60% on instruction?
There are some that spend 80% on administrative costs, if I remember the numbers right, guys. 70?
Not quite 80.
Over 60, for sure. We actually have the whole list.
Can we get a copy of that?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think the task force has been meeting for about 6 months now, is doing good work, but I want to back up their efforts and to encourage them even more to look at the cost of how many centers we have. We have centers of learning, we have campuses, universities, in-state, out-of-country, and to look at ways that we can look at the administrative costs. You know, maybe there are lots of examples with various states that have already gone through this. We're a little bit behind the curve and really having an overall big picture look at administrative costs and sharing of resources within the universities. But that's why I'm putting this executive order out, and that's part of what the task force is doing right now. If they recommend some of that, or if they recommend that different centers or different colleges and universities come under a bigger umbrella of another one, I'll certainly consider that.
What's the expected fiscal?
There, I haven't got one yet, because this is what I'm doing is putting it into effect. Right. That's right. Barbara, what I hope to do is give the next governor a good opportunity with a plan that they can take or not, but the work will all be done for them. And over the last 7 years, I have given well over 24 ideas of ways of consolidating different agencies, services, commissions, boards. We have eliminated some boards and commissions in our state. But it's hard when you have different interest groups that will come to the Capitol and lobby for or against these different things. So my hope is that by these executive orders, they'll have good, solid ideas that they can take and in a plan forward versus starting all over. Because it's been a battle for me over the last 7 years to try to get some of these things done.
School district annexation has been brought up in the past, consolidation. Been a non-starter. There's a lot of school districts that are vehemently opposed to this. Do you think that if this executive order goes through and carries out with the next governor, that this is a likely path forward, that maybe school districts would be open to this or using the weight of the government to push forward with that?
What I hope it will be the weight of the public. I mean, the public has expressed concern about the costs, administrative costs of our schools, and us not being able to pay teachers the salaries that we should. And my goal is to try to get more money into the classroom for the teachers, to find ways to create efficiencies within our systems itself. Now, over the years, there have been schools that have annexed into other schools on their own just because it made financial sense for them. Maybe they couldn't find the personnel in their local community to be able to take a financial manager job or something else. So my hope is that after this detailed analysis by our State Board of Education, by our superintendent, and also by the school districts themselves, who, because of many cuts and budget shortfalls, have had to look at some of this stuff, that we'll be able to find a way to get more money, like I said, to our teachers.
Which other districts do you think would be best annexed or at least consolidating with other ones?
Which one?
Yeah, which ones, I was asking.
Well, you know, over the past 3 years, I have given the legislature policy ideas. In fact, I gave it to them in special session, too. It just didn't get acted upon. That would look at schools that were failing and to look at ways that they might have shared administrative costs, to take the failing schools and put them in with the better schools. But unfortunately, over the last 3 years, I proposed that. No one's taken me up on that offer. Sean?
The Speaker and the pro tem were both critical of your decision
It wasn't a big surprise to me.
Yeah, it was a surprise to them. But have you talked to the Speaker and the Pro Tem?
Yes, I talked to them both the night that I did it.
Okay.
I talked to both the Speaker and the Pro Tem. The Speaker was out of the country Friday night, but I did catch him. And later that night, and I told him exactly what I did. I called the Pro Tem immediately, told him to. I have had lots of legislators contact me, some saying, thank God. You know, if you listen to the debate on the Senate floor in particular, it was just ironic, iconic. I don't know how to even describe the word, but everybody kept saying, for the most part, I don't like this bill. It's making me want to, I mean, you remember one of the senators, making me want to vomit. It makes me nervous. It makes me sick in my stomach, but this is just the best we can do. It's all we can do. And after hearing that type of debate on and on and on by various legislators, I'm sorry I'm having to do this. I want to do this. I just knew in my heart, if I were to sign that, then it would set that stone in place to where it'd be hard to get anything done this next legislative session when we have an election year and we have a $600 million shortfall. I just wasn't willing to give up the fight.
Well, I wanted to just have the Pro Tem and the Speaker agree with you to come back in special session.
I just told them that's what we're going to do. I didn't ask if they agreed with me. I just told them this is what we're going to do and that we would give them a date. Now, I'm sure, I mean, some of the legislators have told me for the past many weeks they were tired, they wanted to go home, and I know that they are. And as I said, many of them have worked well over 40 hours a week just during special session because I've been with them. Many of them have missed birthdays, anniversaries, vacations. Couple of them tell me they're about to lose their outside jobs because they've missed so much time off work. And these are dedicated public servants, by the way, that I'm very grateful that are willing to give of their time and their effort. But as a governor that loves the state of Oklahoma, that is concerned about our image, our brand, our future, what we're doing for or not doing for our children, their education. I even was hearing last week that Commerce was telling me, Governor, you remember that project we've been working on for the last year? Well, they called today and said, Oklahoma's off the list. We're looking at Texas now, or we're looking at whatever state now. And we can't afford to continue having another full year of arguments, especially in election year, when you have the governor, lieutenant governor, every statewide elected official, the House members, all the House could have opponents. They may not, but all the House representatives up for election. All your statewides are up for election. And you got congressional members up for election. We have half the Senate up for election. And we got lots of big issues on the ballot in November of next year that are different for Oklahoma. And we can't suffer another year of getting this bad image of the state as being unstable, not solving its problem, not willing to fix things, cutting down to classes of 4 days a week, to Moody's dropping our state to a credit negative rating because we're rating very limited non-recurring funds into our state budget by using one-time funds to balance stuff. I just couldn't do it.
Because this year under veto, double dips into roads and bridges, causing additional $50 million take out of roads and bridges. I bet you're doing that to try to force the legislature's hand to raise the gas tax.
Well, we did talk in one plan that Speaker voted for, by the way, that dealt with the gas tax, and 71 members of the House voted for on the gas tax in what was called Plan A Plus. Yes, 71 members voted for that. Majority of the Senate, 70. Yeah, three quarters of the Senate voted for the same Plan A Plus plan. Am I trying to get them back to fix the problems? Absolutely, absolutely. And it wasn't a surprise to me that the budget would be out of balance, just as when the Supreme Court kicked out the cigarette cessation fee, that threw the budget out of balance. So by me line item vetoing things in the budget, I knew, it wasn't a surprise, it was intentional to cause the budget to be out of balance because we're not going to fix things unless I force them to come back and to get the job done.
Is there a concern that when they do come back that maybe some of the entrenchment will be exacerbated because you are calling them back for a second special session when the regular session is just a couple months away?
Yeah, a couple of things. Some that have said, let's just come back in February. We'll fix this in February. We'll find some revenue in February. Well, I just went through a full session this year in which we didn't do it. And we left a $400 million hole of one-time funds that we're going to deal with in February. Then we found the $215 million smoking cessation fee kicked out. So now we're up to $615 million. So they came back in 8 weeks of special session, long, hot, debated days and nights, still didn't resolve the problems. And so for those that say we'll come back in February and we'll take care of revenue then, in an election year, as I said, with every statewide elected official, the House members, half the Senate, new governor, new lieutenant governor, you can go down the line, and you think you're going to find revenue during that scenario, when you fall for office in April, and you finish your budget in May, and you have an election in June, anybody want to take me up on a bet that they're going to put a bunch of revenue on the table on that? No, I don't think they're going to do that. And so that's why we got to finish our job and do it now. And
so you feel this is the last opportunity?
No.
Entrenchment or not by?
There are those that are mad, and there are those who are dug in. There are those who will say, I'm not going to do anything. They can say all that stuff. And if I veto something, they can override me. It takes 2/3 vote.
The call is also saying your veto is going to leave healthcare authority $47.1 million short, mental health $21.5 million short, Department of Human Services $42 million short.
Well, yeah, because we didn't use all the one-time funds and the cash and the recurring revenue and CIRB funds that was in the original budget that they passed last week. Yes, but we do know those agencies can keep going. We've asked them, how long can you keep going? I knew they couldn't keep going until June. They couldn't keep going when we went in special session until June. That's why we had special session. But here's what's going to happen. If I had signed that bill, we could have gone to June with 49 agencies receiving cuts, still have a, because we've used 150 some odd million in one-time funds with the bill they passed last week, plus the $400 million left over from last year, it's going to be close to $600 million. You know what they would do next February, starting next February? They would cut $600 million. If they're not going to raise revenue in this session, they didn't raise it in special session, they're not going to come back in election year, raise revenue in that year. So if you think the cuts are bad to the health agencies and human services, just think what $600 million of cuts starting in February of next year will do to all these core services and these agencies. That's why we can't give up on the fight for the people of Oklahoma.
Do you think that any Republicans or Democrats are going to change the vote
on? I've had some call me. Now, I've had various governors. I was with three of the governors on Saturday night, and several of them had told me they're calling members themselves. Just because they say we got to fix things, we can't just keep doing this.
Did these executive orders specifically win you any votes in the legislature?
Would they win me votes?
Yeah.
Well, I hope so. I mean, for all those that say they want more efficiencies, more effectiveness, eliminate waste, I hope so. But it's the right thing to do no matter what. Well, there have been many individuals, civic leaders, some politicians say that we should reduce it back. I mean, we've seen what happens in the U.S. Senate at 60% threshold. It doesn't work in the U.S. Senate. We're at 75% vote. And I think, is it Arkansas is the only other state that has a threshold as high as we do? There's a reason why other states don't have this high of a threshold is because you end up with stalemates like what we're in right now. And then there are other states that just send everything to the vote of the people. You know, when you're elected and paid a salary to do a job, you should do your job and make hard decisions. That's what I've been doing for a long period of time. and I'm still here, making hard decisions and still being reelected. So I think it is reasonable. I think it's necessary that we look at what should that threshold be. Should it be 60%? Should it be 65? I've heard a couple of people say, I'm leading the initiative petition to get the people to think about that. Because basically what you have is the majority of Oklahomans that voted to put in Republicans, but yet you had the minority, because you couldn't get anything passed without the minority controlling everything in the state. And that wasn't how 640 was intended to be.
Governor, do you think Speaker McCall could have gotten those 5 more votes to get to the 76 threshold if he wanted that grand bargain to pass?
Well, let's put it this way. I put my foot down this week saying we can do better. And, you know, I don't know, but can't remember how much of his leadership team didn't support him, but he had a lot of his own members that did not support him in that vote. So I would hope we could do better.
I got to ask you about this. Yesterday, you took to Twitter, you slammed the story, mine as being inaccurate. Many of the facets of it you said were inaccurate. The questions that I asked your office, the office wouldn't answer. Can you address that?
Yeah. Well, in fact, I watched your. I don't want to get personal with you, Aaron. I'll be happy to talk to you off camera